Welcome in this video of the House of Asian Cinema. Begun in 1977, the Star Wars saga is an international popular culture behemoth. No more than 10 films strong, with several TV series and cartoons, many video games and role-playing games, and countless comics and books, its cultural weight is massive. A mix of many different influences, from Western to 1930s science fiction films, Asian cinema and Asian culture as a whole have also played an important part in the development of its universe. When discussing the Asian influence of Star Wars, the information which is always repeated in every publication is how important Akira Kurosawa's Hidden Fortress was in the script-making process. For sure, George Lucas was an authentic fan of the Japanese master and of Chambara in general. But aside from a couple of plot points, such as the peasant viewpoints replaced by R2-D2 and C-3PO, or the presence of a princess and a general trying to save her, the movie, which was released in 1977, didn't have much to do with Kurosawa's work. The explanation can be found in the first writing attempts of Lucas. In his first synopsis, Star Wars is no more no less than a science fiction copy of the Hidden Fortress. This aspect would still be present in the first script. It makes sense Lucas considered at some point to buy the rights to remake the Japanese film. Other Kurosawa's work influences were present in this first script, such as Yojimbo and Sanjuro. But during the long rewriting process, the story of Star Wars would gradually drift away from its original model to find its own identity and only keep a few discrete references to the body of work of the Japanese master. Another Japanese film, much less known than Kurosawa's Hidden Fortress, could have been a major influence in Star Wars story writing based on their similarities. The film in question is Magic Serpent by Tetsuya Yamauchi. In this 1966 movie, the heir of a fallen lord, Ikazuchi Maru, has been trained during all his childhood by an old wizard in ninja techniques. Understand here ninja techniques as magical ones. One day, Ikazuchi Maru meets Tsunade, a young woman seeking a father. He joins her quest following the death of his master, killed by Orochimaru, former disciple of the wizard and now main henchman of the traitor who took over the former lord. Ikazuchi Maru is obviously Luke Skywalker and Tsunade Leia, with a few variations, the father issue being given to the Tatooine boy in George Lucas' version. The wizard is Obi-Wan Kenobi and Orochimaru Darth Vader. There is also a scene reminiscent of the Jedi mind trick used by Obi-Wan to avoid the Stormtrooper's attention when arriving in Tatooine. Some elements even foreshadow Empire Strikes Back, such as when Daijo Yuki, the treacherous new lord, proposed to his daughter to rule their kingdom together. George Lucas has never referenced the film as an inspiration, so it is difficult to assess exactly if the film had indeed an influence on the story making of Star Wars. But there are enough similarities to be worth a mention here. The concept of the Force derives from the belief in Chi, or Ki in Japanese, the idea of a life force which binds all living forms. But this influence probably comes less from Lucas' own research on the subject than through the introduction to the West of such concepts by the counterculture of the 60s and 70s and gathered under the generic term of New Age, very popular on the west coast of the United States when Lucas was working on the script of the film. Similar concepts were also present in some popular science fiction books during that period. Still motivated by his love for samurai films, Lucas suggested Darth Vader to wear a helmet similar to those the samurai adorned during their military campaigns. He brought some visual references from a book to the artist chosen to deliver the concept design, Ralph McQuarrie. McQuarrie used these references and combined them with others to come up with the iconic design we are now so familiar with. The first attempt to design Obi-Wan Kenobi's costume also show a clear influence toward feudal Japan. The Japanese connection also made Lucas consider the possibility to use Japanese actors for all his cast before narrowing it to two main characters, Obi-Wan Kenobi and Princess Leia. To give life to the old Jedi Master, he logically proposed to Kurosawa's most famous actor, Toshiro Mifune. But the Japanese star didn't follow up on the offer. According to his daughter, he was also offered the part of Darth Vader, but once again, he didn't accept it. Other inspirations from Akira Kurosawa's work can be found in Lucasfilm. For instance, the iconic shot in which Luke watched the double sun of Tatooine looks very similar to another shot from Desu Uzula, the Japanese master had directed 2 years earlier. Some Wuxia fans, the stories of Chinese swordsmen, have seen many similarities in the Star Wars saga on the Jin Yong novels, Return of the Condor Heroes. It is certain George Lucas never read the original novels, and it's very unlikely he ever saw the following TV and film adaptations. But the confusion from Chinese fans is understandable because, to some extent, Star Wars is indeed a Western version of a martial art film. In an article titled Martial Art Film as Global Cinema, Yunsun Lee defined Chinese martial arts films based on 5 criteria: conflicts between rival martial arts styles or clans, climatic duel, a strong emphasis on the relationship between master and student, a discussion of how self-mastery leads to victory over one's external opponent, a romance of the hero either engage with or turn away from. Even if we can consider these criteria as too restrictive, they help us set a foundation to analyze films belonging to this genre. And they are indeed present in many kung fu films, such as The One-Armed Boxer, Drunken Master, or Marshall Club. And if we take the trilogy as a whole, and especially when looking at The Empire Strikes Back, all these criteria are indeed present, making of Star Wars an Americanized, Westernized version of Chinese martial art films, thanks to the integration of more familiar ingredients for this audience, such as Western, Swords and Sandals, Second World War, or Vietnam. The prelogy seems to confirm this idea given how many elements borrowed from Chinese martial arts mythology are present. Of course, there are still some Japanese influences, such as the use of a decoy queen to fool the enemy in The Phantom Menace, an idea once again taken from The Hidden Fortress. But it is Chinese elements which dominate, and in the first place when it comes to the fights. While in the original trilogy, the Jedi duels were inspired by Chambara and Western swordplay, trilogy choreographies belong more to the Wuxia world with their more fantasy and operatic designs. It makes sense Lucas considered at some point to hire Sammo Hung to take charge of the fight scenes of Attack of the Clones. Likewise, while the Jedi of the original trilogy call to mind the samurais, the ones of the prelogy are closer to Shaolin monks. The Shaolin Temple destruction, a founding event of the monastery mythology, and its consequences seems to have been transposed directly in Revenge of the Sith. These borrowings and reinvention in a cultural world more easily digestible by Western audience are part of a larger process of acceptation of martial arts and Asian philosophic concepts in the West. It is of the same vein as the occupation of Japan by the United States following the Second World War, the opening of many American soldiers to the practice of karate, jiu-jitsu, and judo, or later the breakthrough of Bruce Lee all over the world. This integration has been so successful that the Force has gained for some community the status of a real religion, and some attempts have been made to structure the lightsaber practice to get the recognition of an authentic martial arts. Thank you for having watched this video. I hope it will give you another perspective on the cult Star Wars saga. Don't hesitate to post your questions or observations in the comment section below. I will do another video to answer them. The next video will deal with the opposite phenomenon, on how Star Wars influenced Asian cinema. Until then, I hope to see you back soon on the House of Asian Cinema.